Hi, my name is Stephanie. I'm a stay-at-home homeschooling mom to three little ones and a passionate advocate for women's health. Prior to becoming a mother, I was a D1 track and field coach, and way before that, I was a two-time NCAA national champion in the pole vault, a collegiate gymnast, and an NCAA Woman of the Year honoree. I have a Bachelor of Science in Exercise Science and a Master of Science in Sport Management. And through it all, I have been literally peeing in my pants. Whether male or female, your pelvic floor serves an irreplaceable role in your body. Made up of muscles, connective tissues, nerves, and part of your core, not only does it help you move, laugh, cough, breathe, and have sex, but it holds your organs up and your stool and urine in. Pelvic floor dysfunction is when it is not fulfilling these roles. Common symptoms may include leaking of urine, pain with intercourse, back pain, or pelvic organ prolapse. It can happen for a multitude of reasons, such as injury, pregnancy, aging, or even chronic constipation. While it can affect all genders, it is much more common in women. If you have a mother, sister, wife, daughter, or girlfriend, if it's not you, odds are someone you know is dealing with core dysfunction, and it is prevalent. Studies have shown that as many as 1 in 3 women will experience some form of pelvic floor dysfunction within their lifetime. Depending on the root cause, in many cases, it can be both preventable and treatable. Yet, whether it be from the stigma associated with it, underreporting, misdiagnoses, lack of education, or mismanagement of care, so many do not receive the help that they truly need. So what about me? Now, before I start, for those of you who know me and don't wish to know that much about me, I highly recommend you turn around and walk out now, because things are gonna get really real here. This is your warning. For me, it started when I was a teenager, around 15, as a gymnast. I was this shy, incredibly awkward, insecure young woman, and one day I was tumbling and for whatever reason just peed in my pants, again and again. I was mortified. I had no idea what was going on. I thought to myself that maybe it was just a fluke. Maybe I drank too much water before going to practice or something. But then it just kept happening over and over again, day after day. I was too shy to say anything to anyone, but I knew that people knew. In the beginning, I didn't even think to wear a pad, so it definitely showed at times. In addition, several of my teammates would ask with a knowing tone things like, "Why do you run to the bathroom all the time? Why did you have to change your leotard? Did you just spill water on your shorts?" At the time, I felt guilt, shame, confusion. Why me? What was wrong with me? In hindsight, though, I feel anger, resentment, outrage. Where were my coaches, my network, my support system? Where were the adults looking out for me as a kid? This went on for years, club gymnastics to high school gymnastics to collegiate gymnastics. Not once in all of my years as an athlete was I ever offered help or guidance by a coach or trainer. No one even acknowledged it. During those first few years, I spoke with my family doctor very quietly, very quaintly, without ever learning what the root cause was, based only on a few questions. I was prescribed medication for an overactive bladder and told to drink less water before practices. Another time, another doctor, again without an exam, I was referred to a physical therapist who sat me down behind a curtain in a busy room and asked if I'd like to use the biofeedback device. Now, this is where you take a wand attached to a cord, attached to a computer, and you insert it into your vagina to monitor your efforts. I don't want to do that now as a mother of 3 kids, having lost all sense of modesty and privacy through my pregnancies and births, let alone as a teenager behind a curtain in a busy room. Politely declining, I was instead given a handout of stick figures doing various core exercises. I never went back. In addition to gymnastics, I began pole vaulting. At first, I was completely asymptomatic, but as time went on, as with any condition left untreated, my symptoms worsened. Eventually, even pole vault left me frustrated and in tears, doubting absolutely everything about me and my body. Pelvic floor health is tricky like that. While it's a physical condition, it's truly a lifestyle issue, leaving its mark on you mentally, emotionally, socially, and relationally. Now, sometime after college, I talked with my OB about my experience as an athlete, my family history of pelvic floor dysfunction, my desire to have children, and my hope to avoid surgery down the line. She said, "Better start doing your Kegels now." I felt dismissed, unheard, and still very much in the dark. Pushing for answers, I asked, "How do you do them? How many? How often?" Now, I know an OB is not in the business of exercise prescription, but I was told to just squeeze like I was trying to stop a flow of urine whenever I thought about it. watching TV, driving in the car, sitting in a stoplight. Maybe I should even put a few sticky notes up around to help me remember. As someone who just graduated with a degree in exercise science, my gut told me there had to be more to it than that. But I took her advice and I just started squeezing away. Then I had my first child. A second degree tear to my perineum, a society that told me I had to immediately bounce back postpartum, the mind of a former collegiate athlete, and on top of it all, I was a new mother, completely overwhelmed with being a new mother. I showed up for my 6-week postpartum check. The doctor examined me for 2 seconds, told me I was good to go to do whatever I wanted to do. You can only imagine what happened. Though I was peeing in my pants when I coughed and sneezed, even though I never did any kind of core retraining, it wasn't even suggested. Without someone telling me to start small and simple, you guessed it, I dove headfirst into the world of fitness. I was doing HIIT, I was running, I was jumping, I was getting my body back. Even with my experience in education, I just didn't know. I didn't know what my body needed, where to start, how to progress, or even who to turn to for help. I was given the all clear. The doctor should know, right? She should have my best interest in mind, right? She wouldn't let me do anything that would potentially hurt me, right? Yes, things got worse. Fast forward 19 months, I had another baby. Thankfully, no tearing this time around, but I also no longer felt like diving back in to reclaim my body. I was burned out and my body felt like pulp. It was time to slow things down. I started Googling things, symptoms, exercises, treatments, just help me. I was finally starting to take charge of my pelvic health. I went to see yet another doctor. I told her my spiel again, history, symptoms, worries, and fears, and I finally asked for clarity. What is this elusive Kegel that everybody is talking about? Is it really all that it's cracked up to be? Will it really fix all of my problems? Is there anything else that can help me? She literally printed off a 1-page piece of paper on how to Kegel. This was the last straw. I was done being ashamed. I was done being timid. I wanted answers. I booked an appointment on my own without a referral to a physical therapist who saw pelvic floor cases. While I showed up full of hope, my frustration would only escalate. Now let's pause for a second. There are a lot of ways that you can get help for any number of ailments. There's a lot of people you can see. They will all handle things a little bit differently, and some will be better than others. Healthcare can even vary region to region. Some things will naturally fall through the cracks. We are all human, even our providers. I get that. I wasn't expecting perfection, but we're going on 20 years here and numerous doctors. You would think that someone somewhere along the line would have had some answers, or at least would have been able to point me in the right direction. But back to PT. I will give her credit. She attempted to help me learn how to Kegel through external feedback. She gave me legitimate core exercises and a simple progression to follow. But I was still without a diagnosis. I still didn't know why all of this was happening or what we were actually trying to fix. And when I told her I suspected prolapse as I was experiencing symptoms, she dismissed my concerns completely and said, I couldn't possibly have that because I wasn't overweight. Now, whether I did or did not, a broad sweeping statement without an actual physical exam is simply unacceptable. Seemingly out of resources, out of patience, and hungry for change and help, I went online. Cue Dr. Google. I found a woman in Canada who specializes in core retraining, signed up for her class, and devoured all of the information I could regarding the pelvic floor, core dysfunction, and exercise prescription. This was the beginning of truly owning my story. This was also right around the same time when I started wondering about other women. Here I am with a degree in exercise science, having been a collegiate coach, a high-level athlete, fairly fit, no major health concerns, relatively easy pregnancies and births, relatively young, especially when things started. I had health insurance, I was eager to find answers, and maybe most importantly, I was brave enough to ask questions. So what about other women with less advantages and greater obstacles? What are their stories and their experiences like? I couldn't help but feel like I was just seeing the tip of the iceberg, that this problem, this lack of information, guidance, and support was deeper and more widespread than most cared to admit. That perhaps it wasn't just me that was missed in the system, that perhaps the system was not set up to help and heal the whole woman. that perhaps there's a huge piece of the puzzle in women's health that is being glossed over by the majority, making my story more common than I originally thought. But isn't that what happens with most taboo topics? They tend to be hidden away, talked about in hushed voices, and ignored, at least on the surface, so as to not offend or embarrass anyone. But what's so taboo about a muscular system in the body? Who cares if it involves urine, stool, and sex? If it's not functioning, shouldn't it be treated with the same care and respect as any other system in the body? If a baseball player tore his rotator cuff in a game, wouldn't he be seen by a doctor, diagnosed with an injury, given appropriate rehab progressions, and then given the all clear to play again only after he was fully healed and his body was able to handle the work demanded of it? Then why, might I ask, can a woman in the United States carry a baby for 9 months, go through who knows how many hours of labor and delivery, tear herself from vagina to anus, and there not be a protocol in place? Why is she not immediately given resources, specific steps to follow, and a referral to a specialist? She deserves an entire network, let alone just a little bit of guidance and education to help her get back on her feet. And all of this should be done prior to be given the all clear. Instead, I fear that most women are just given a sympathetic smile as she is handed her ice pack, Tylenol, and her peri bottle, and then sent on her way. We have to ask ourselves, why are coaches and trainers not given the tools and resources needed to address and guide athletes with core dysfunction? Why are women feeling dismissed when they tell their doctor that they pee in their pants? Why are women being cleared postpartum when they are clearly not healed? Why are women being treated for core dysfunction prior to an actual diagnosis? Why is core dysfunction treated as normal and just a burden we women must bear for having children, or God forbid, for aging? I refuse to accept that just because something is common, it is normal, and that I will just pee in my pants until the day that I die. Instead, I firmly believe that with a proper diagnosis and a little TLC, I can and will change what has been a burden for so many years. Now let's fast forward to postpartum with baby number 3. Knowing what I knew, knowing that I deserved better, and truly believing that given the chance, my body would prove capable, I specifically asked to be referred to see a pelvic floor physical therapist who does internal exams. And that's exactly what I got. Thanks to my PT, after so many years of waiting, I was finally given a diagnosis. I was told that I had a hypertonic pelvic floor, so my muscles were actually too tight and not able to go through the full range of motions. So this idea of more Kegels equals stronger was actually making my simple symptoms worse. I had a weak pelvic floor, an uncoordinated pelvic floor, so the contractions and the movements were out of sync, a bladder prolapse, my bladder had dropped out of optimal position, and a little bit of diastasis rectus abdominis, or a separation of the abs. I finally learned how to do a Kegel. I was finally given a true exercise prescription for my core. My progress is finally able to be monitored and assessed as we move along. And most of this would not have been possible without a skilled pelvic floor physical therapist who works internally. And it has helped, you may ask? Yes, a million times yes. In only a few short weeks, I saw improvements, and within a few months, I was stronger than I was pre-babies. I can finally cough, sneeze, run, and jump without peeing in my pants. No, it's not perfect yet. I still have my moments. But if there's anything that my journey has taught me, it's that health is a lifetime commitment and healing is not linear. I know that with time and intentionality, I will only continue to improve. Yet, I cannot help but wonder, what if I would have gotten help sooner? 5, 10, 15 years ago, would my symptoms have gotten as bad as they did? Would my pregnancies, labors, and deliveries have been any easier? Would I have been able to avoid a prolapse altogether? Would my quality of life and relationships have been any better over the years? Pelvic floor health impacts the whole person. It touches every single aspect of someone's life. While poor health is not life-threatening, it is most definitely life-diminishing. And that's something worth fighting for. If my story can help just one person live a fuller, more stress-free life, if my experience can empower just one woman to find her voice and the courage to speak up, that's worth me getting up here and telling the world that I'm a chronic pee-in-my-pantser, or at least that I was. So where do we go from here? I want to challenge you. Help me drop the stigma of incontinence and other core dysfunctions. The more we talk about it, the more honest we are about it, the less taboo it will become. No, we don't all have to do a TED talk about it, but we can start having real conversations about it with those we trust. Talk to your mom, daughters, husbands, wives, sisters, friends about your experiences. Open up that conversation for change. If you are a coach or a trainer, learn about core dysfunction, routinely screen for it, know what symptoms to look out for, and know where you can refer your athletes and clients to. Do not be afraid to bring it up if needed. You might just be changing that person's life. If you are a person with a pelvic floor, AKA everybody, seek out information on how to take care of it and what symptoms to look for in a non-functioning core. If you are experiencing symptoms, do not allow anyone to dismiss you or your desire for help, regardless of your age, fitness level, education level, how many children you may or may not have, or how you gave birth. Insist on a diagnosis. Request to see a pelvic floor physical therapist and refuse to settle just because something is common. And last but not least, if you are pregnant or having recently given birth, know that you need to progress slowly. Do not accept that postpartum bodies are just supposed to bounce back. And resist the urge to go from 0 to 100 just 6 short weeks after birth. Find a pelvic floor physical therapist and give your body the time and the grace that it needs to heal. I stand before you today not as a medical professional or exercise specialist, but as a woman, mother, and friend urging you to join me in my crusade of demanding more of our healthcare system and fitness professionals. Help me drop the stigma of pelvic floor health. Share your stories, voice your concerns, and refuse to suffer in silence. You are truly not alone. Perhaps together, we can create the support network in women's health that is so desperately needed. Thank you.